We've been studying through Ephesians, and we've been going down through verse 18 and following these verses about being filled with the Spirit. And it's an interesting thing when he says in verse 5:18, be not drunk with wine when it is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, we've been over that verse enough for you to understand that if you take that verse and you match it with Colossians 3:16, which is its companion comparable verse in Colossians, where it says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart unto the Lord, you'll see that that is that issue of having the word of Christ dwell in you richly, producing the teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and so forth. What happens in Ephesians 5:18 when you're filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in verse 19, in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs, making melody in your heart to the Lord, giving thanks always, the issue in Colossians and Ephesians is that what being filled with the Spirit in Ephesians does, the result of it, is exactly the same result as having the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in Colossians. And so what generally is done is you say, well, if A, Ephesians equals B, Colossians, then you know the two things are equal to each other. And so the easiest way to identify what Paul's talking about when it talks about being filled with the Spirit is to understand he's talking about the Spirit of God filling, controlling, captivating your life, empowering your life through the Word of Christ. That is, the Word of God, since the Spirit of God wrote His Word, when the Spirit of God moves and works in the Scripture, it's always through His Word. You go back to the very first time you see the Spirit of God show up in the Bible in Genesis chapter number 1. God wanted to move upon the face of the waters, and what did He do? The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and He said. And the speaking is how the Spirit of God moved in creation. And so you go three verses in your Bible, and you understand how God, the Holy Spirit, is going to work in people's lives. I was listening this morning as we were coming to the meetings, our radio program, and the guy that's on right after us, fortunately we were about 5 minutes out, so I didn't hear but about 5 minutes of it, but he was talking about God working in people's lives, and he had this thing over here going and this thing over here going, and it's sort of a potpourri of all kind of events and circumstances, and you never know what it is or who it is. In the Bible, you don't have a question about whether it's the God of the Bible. I was in Arizona last week, and the meeting out there last weekend, and there was some people there, a lady there who was a Mormon. And she said, I came to a Bible conference because I'm interested in studying the Bible. But then she says, but you know, the Bible's not enough. You need the Book of Mormons and all this stuff. And she's explaining to me how all these things are so much, much more helpful when you study these things and that thing. And everything about what she was basing her faith on was experiences, visions, and the golden plates and all this kind of stuff. And I kept showing her that verse in 2 Timothy 3 that the Word of God is profitable, and it's given that the man of God might be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. It's perfect. Once you've got God's Word, you don't need anything else. And you don't need the Book of Mormons. You don't need Judge Rutherford. You don't need Muhammad. You don't need anything else. You've got the written Word of the Creator, and He wrote it in a book, preserved it through history, and that book is where He speaks. And it's through His words that He works. Well, that's what being filled with the Spirit is having your life brought under the control of the Spirit of God through the application of His Word. And when you take your faith, rest in His Word, and you apply it, that's God's Spirit working in your life. Now, that issue in Ephesians, if you come back with me to chapter 1, when you come to the book of Ephesians, you find the working of the Holy Spirit through the book. And it's fascinating to see how the Holy Spirit works in the book of Ephesians. Just like in chapter 5, when you put His Word and your life under the control of His Word, you're putting your life under the control of the Spirit of God. It's an objective standard that you know what it is. It's not based on feelings and hunches and religious experiences. It's based on truth and a book that your faith can rest in. Then it will confirm itself in your experience. In the book of Ephesians, the Holy Spirit Himself is mentioned a number of times. And it's fascinating to follow through how in the book of Ephesians, you find the Holy Spirit. If you go to the book of Romans, the Holy Spirit isn't mentioned until chapter 5, and he's mentioned one time. And you have to get over to chapter 8 before you find him mentioned repeated time, 19 times in chapter 8. But you've gone that far in the book of Romans before you really get any information about the operating and working of the Holy Spirit. Ephesians starts off pretty early, Ephesians chapter 1, verse number 12. That you should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom, that is, in Christ, you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. Now you notice the sequence of events here. He's not putting timing in here to say there's a long distance between it, but he's just giving you what theologians call the order of salvation. First, you hear the word of truth, the life-giving message of God's word, the gospel of your salvation. You hear that, and then you trust Christ because you heard about Christ dying for your sins, being buried and raised again for your justification. You heard the gospel, and that motivated you to trust the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in whom also, after you believed, in response to your faith in Christ, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Notice that in response to your trust in Christ to be the Savior that he died and rose again for you to be, God responds by doing a number of things. This one, the issue is, after that you believed, you were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Now notice it's after you believe. Faith is first. There's a whole theological system that says God, the Holy Spirit has to come, regenerate you, then give you faith. The Spirit of God doesn't seal you until after you've believed. He works in response to our faith. The only response grace will accept is faith, but it requires faith. And when you've trusted Christ, then the Holy Spirit seals you. You notice he says you're sealed with the Holy Spirit. You're not sealed by him. It's not something he does to you. It's something he becomes to you. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance. So first he seals you. Now a seal has to do with security. If you come with me to Revelation chapter number 20, for example, Revelation chapter 20, there's a great contrast between two different seals in the Bible. If you look at Revelation chapter 20 in one hand, and Matthew chapter 27 in the other, Matthew 27, when the Lord Jesus Christ died, he was put by his disciples into a tomb. A stone was rolled over that tomb door. And then the Jews went to Pilate and said, you know, we're afraid that something's going to happen because he said he was going to rise again. And so Matthew 27, verse 62, now the next day that followed after the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, Matthew 27, 63, saying, sir, we remember that this deceiver said, while he was yet alive, after 3 days I will rise again. Command, therefore, that the sepulcher be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night, steal away his body, steal him away, and say unto the people, he is risen from the dead, so the last error will be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, you have a watch, go your way, make it sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulcher sure, sealing the stone and setting a watch. So they sealed the stone. Why did they seal it? So that it would be secure and couldn't be opened. Next chapter. In the beginning of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. The seal didn't work. The angel broke the seal. So the security that it was being provided there by that seal didn't work. And by the way, the watchers didn't do too well either. And the angel rolls a stone away so the people that came could see that Christ was no longer there. He didn't need the stone rolled away to get out. He got out on his own. If he could walk through a wall and enter into a room where the disciples were and they didn't, you know, they got the doors locked and the windows nailed down, and he had that capacity to do that, he didn't need to worry about the rock, the stone. That was taken away so the people could see that it was empty. Angel tells him in Luke 24, come and see where he lay. He's risen. He's not here. They needed to be able to get in. But my point to you is that they had a seal that was there for security. It didn't work. Now here's a seal, Revelation 20, that God sets. Revelation 20, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key to the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years, and cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. So God puts a seal on Satan in the bottomless pit, and he says that you're there and you're going to be there for 1,000 years. If you come down to verse number 7, and when 1,000 years were expired, Satan was loosed out of his prison. So how long did he stay there? Exactly how long God said. You think he stayed there because he wanted to? No, but God set a seal that kept him securely intact. Daniel, in Daniel chapter 6, is cast into the lion's den, if you remember the story. And a seal was set upon the lion's den that nobody could let him out. In your Bible, a seal primarily is the idea of security. So when you trust the Lord Jesus Christ, there are 5 things that happen to you. You're circumcised, you're crucified with Christ. You're regenerated, you're given his life, you're quickened. You're indwelt, you become the temple of the Holy Spirit. Then you're baptized into the body of Christ, C-R-I-B, and then the S is sealed. All those things are permanently attached to you by the presence of God the Holy Spirit in your life. And you literally, as a believer, live in sort of an encapsulized environment. In the mornings, my wife gives me these capsules to take. I have one medicine to take from the doctor for my heart. It's a little bitty, small dose of a heart medicine, and the rest of them are probiotics and vitamins and all kind of stuff my wife gives me to take, and several of them are in little capsules, and you can take that capsule and open it up, and all the powder, all the stuff in it falls out, but the capsule is, the material is sealed with that capsule, it's encased in that, and that's what the Holy Spirit is. He's the capsule, he's the seal, he's the security. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. You don't need angels to take care of you. You don't need other, you know, priests or pundits or media. You have God the Holy Ghost. You have the third member of the Godhead as your personal resident seal and protector. And his presence, he's the Holy Spirit of promise. And the promise is in verse 14, which is the earnest of the inheritance. He is the down payment of the fact that God is going to give, has given you, and you will possess an inheritance in the heavenly. You're made heirs of God, joiners with Jesus Christ. And he's the earnest of that, the down payment of it, the foretaste of that, until the redemption of the purchased possession. Now come over to chapter 4. Chapter 4, verse 30. Here's how secure the seal is. Chapter 4, verse 30. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed unto the day of redemption. The Holy Spirit is your seal, the guarantor, the security of your identity in Christ until the day of the redemption of our body. That is the event we call the rapture, talking about the resurrection. When you inherit, when you receive the inheritance, the redemption of the purchased possession. You belong to him, and that day of redemption, you're sealed right out there until that day of redemption. The redemption, there's Romans 8, verse 23, the redemption of your body, that is the resurrection. So your salvation is secure based upon the finished work of Christ, based upon the gospel of your salvation, but the mechanics of the securing of it is that you've been placed into Christ and then sealed there with the person of the Holy Spirit. It's his job, one of his functions, is to protect you in Christ and make it so that you don't get out. I like that verse in chapter 4, verse 30, when he says, "Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you're sealed." Sometimes you and I do things that if it was based upon what we do, maybe I shouldn't say sometimes, all the time if it's based upon what we do, we're going to come up short. But because God isn't dealing with us on the basis of what we do with regard to our justification and acceptance before him, he can say, "Grieve not the Holy Spirit." Well, if he said don't do it, the probability is you do do it. The issue is your security is you're sealed in Christ. So the Holy Spirit's ministry starts out in Ephesians by being your guarantor, your seal. Now look at Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18. Here's the second reference. And by the way, sometimes people have verse number 17 as a reference to the Holy Spirit. And this is not the Spirit of Christ. This is not the Holy Spirit here. Ephesians 1:17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, would give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. When he says, "Give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation," he's not praying that God would give the Ephesian believers the Holy Spirit. They already have the Holy Spirit. When he says, "the spirit of wisdom and revelation," that's like he would say, talk about the spirit of slumber, the spirit of sleep. He's talking about the attitude, the thinking process. There is a spirit associated with wisdom and revelation that God would have you and I to have. And he said, "God's given you this revelation. I want the attitude that wisdom and revelation is designed to produce in you to be what resides in you." So he's not, that passage sometimes is listed as a reference to the Holy Spirit, but I don't think it is because, as I said, you already have the Holy Spirit. I already just told you back in verse 13. So there's no need for him to pray that you would be given the Holy Spirit. You already have him. And every time you say that word spirit, it doesn't mean the Holy Spirit. And the people go back to Isaiah chapter 11 and say, you know, the spirit, the seven spirits back there where there really aren't seven. It's a crazy use of that passage. But anyway, the second was in chapter 2, verse number 18. Ephesians 2:18, "For through him we have access by one spirit unto the Father." Now that verse is interesting for a couple of reasons. All three of the members of the Godhead are at work there. And if you've read this far in Ephesians, if you start in chapter 1, you notice over and over Ephesians talks about the Father doing it, the Spirit, Son doing it, the Spirit doing it. The three members of the Godhead, the Father, the Word, the Spirit. Through him, through the Lord Jesus Christ, through the cross work of Christ, back in verse 13 it says, "But now in Christ Jesus you who sometime were far off are made nigh," how? "By the blood of Christ." Through his shed blood at Calvary, we both, Jew and Gentile, have access by one Spirit unto the Father. The only way you can come to the Father is through the blood of the Lord, the blood of Christ. When Jesus told his disciples, "I am the way, the truth, the life, no man comes to the Father but by me," they didn't understand the depth of what he said, but he was telling them the bottom line of it. No one gets to God, the God of heaven, except through the Lord Jesus Christ. And you get through to him through the Lord Jesus Christ through his blood. So it's based upon the cross work of Christ. We can have access to God the Father, but that access to God the Father is by one Spirit. In other words, he's literally the member of the Godhead. Christ is sort of like the ground that we walk on. The Father is the goal, And it's the Holy Spirit that's the one that kind of takes you by the hand and walks you into his presence. That word access is a wonderful word. Go back to Romans chapter 5. A verse like it. You know, when you have access to something, it means you can get there and use what's there. I was using my computer, and we got all kind of computers around here. And Wednesday night, someone needed a DVD. Well, you go in the media room, and I stay away from the computers in the media room because I don't want to be the one that messes them up. But if you want to get the information, there's probably 1,000 different DVDs registered there. If you want to get one, you have to get access to it. They're all there, but I didn't know how to get access to it so I could pull it out and use it. So I waited for my wife to come. She knows how to do that. She's working on some of it right now. And Bob's written all those programs, but they're sent in. A couple of the other folks know how to operate these things. And she goes, she says, oh, that's simple. Fires the thing up, hits the screen, punches 3 buttons, and there it is. Now, the key there is you got to know which 3 buttons to push. See, that's the key. You got to have, but she got access. And in about 45 seconds, there's a DVD printed, and it's ready to go. And I could give, there you go. Well, if you want to have access, you have to have the way to get there. She knew the code. Well, the code to have access to the Father is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Access is the ability to get the information, get the stuff, and then bring it into use. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Notice right now, we don't only have justification, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, all that God has done for us through the cross work of Christ. You and I have access into all of that grace when we stand, and we have it by faith. That's what he's, by the way, when you have it by faith, it's faith in what? Faith in God's Word. Who wrote God's Word? The Holy Spirit. So it's the ministry of the Holy Spirit through His Word that gives us access when our faith is resting in an understanding of His Word to us. It gives us the ability to go in and get the things that God has given us in Christ and bring them into our experience. So it's through Him, through Christ. It's based on His merits that we have access, but it's by the Spirit. It's our faith resting in who God has made us in His Son, based on what Christ has done for us, what the Spirit of God tells us in His Word, that we have access unto the Father. Come back to Ephesians and look at the other use of that word, chapter 3, verse 12. The word access is used 3 times by Paul. Ephesians 3, verse number 11, he says, according to the eternal purpose which He purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by the faith of Him. It's based upon His faithfulness that we are able to boldly, you read this, you say, that's an amazing verse. We have boldness and access. You can come boldly into the Father's presence and have complete access, never barred. Do you go places where the doors and they say, you know, employees only, official access only, and you look at that and you think, I'd like to go back and see what's back there, but you can't. I've been at the airport the last 3 weeks, probably 8 times, and every time you go, you have to have security clearance. You have to have access to this, access to that. And you're in the line waiting, and somebody comes along, they've got a little card, and they go up, and they go right in, you know. And you say, wow, you know, that's a special person. Well, there's no place you don't have access to. And it's through the ministry. The Holy Spirit's job is to take the things that God has given you in Christ and make them real, operative in your life. And that's done as your faith rests upon the revelation He's given you in His Word. Now, that brings us to the next reference in Ephesians. Well, not quite yet, but chapter 2, verse 21. 2:21, in whom all the building, fitly framed together, groweth unto an holy temple in the Lord, in whom also ye also are builded together for a habitation of God through the Spirit. You see, what the Holy Spirit is doing today is forming the church, the body of Christ, a place in which God Himself chooses to live. That's why 1 Timothy 3 calls us the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. We're not the church of the dead God. They had a dead God at Ephesus. She was called the Queen of Heaven. She was called Greatest Diana of Ephesus. People worshiped her. Israel was worshiping her back in Jeremiah chapter 44, worshiping the Queen of Heaven. We have people in Chicago that worship her, where our old building was over on Neve Avenue in Chicago that wasn't very far from there. She had a church named after her. You can go all the way back to Genesis chapter 11. You can go all the way back to Genesis chapter 4, and you find people worshiping this goddess. She's the church of the dead God, the fallen God. You're the church of the living God. Different kind of deal. That's because we're the habitation of God through the Spirit. Paul tells the Romans, if the Spirit of Christ dwell in you, it's through the operating of the Holy Spirit in you that Christ dwells in you, and Christ in you is the hope of glory. That's quite a status. That's quite a standing that you and I have. 1 Corinthians 6, he tells you that, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Then 1 Corinthians 3, he tells the Corinthian church, you, that local church, are the church. You're the temple of the Spirit. That's why he says to the church there in 1 Timothy, the church at Ephesus, that you're the church of the living God. We're the place that represents Him. We're the pillar and the ground of the truth. It's our job to hold up the truth of the living God. That's not because we have the correct address or a certain kind of building. It's because of what God's doing in us individually and corporately as the church, the body of Christ. Now, chapter 3 of Ephesians, verse number 5, he says in verse 3, if you have heard of the verse 2, Ephesians 3, 2, if you have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you, how that by revelation He made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men. So there's a special message given to the Apostle Paul called the mystery. Previous to Paul, it was not made known to the sons of men. Verse 9, he says, to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. From the beginning of the world, God never told anybody this secret. Until He came to the Apostle Paul, came to Saul of Tarsus, made him Paul the Apostle, and by revelation, Christ made known this secret to Paul. That's why he calls it the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began, but now it's made manifest. Now, that truth, once it's made known to Paul, verse 5, which in other ages was not made known to the sons of men, as it is now revealed. So revealed by Christ to Paul, but watch the rest of the verse. It is now revealed unto His holy apostles and prophets, how? By the Spirit. Paul had it revealed directly from Christ to him, but then through his ministry and his preaching, the Spirit of God revealed it to others. So it's the Spirit of God that reveals the information. Now, it's important to understand how He does it. Look at verse 4. whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge and the mystery of Christ. How is someone in verse 4 going to understand Paul's knowledge and the mystery of Christ? They have to read. As I wrote a 4, they have to read his epistles. How does the Holy Spirit reveal truth to people? Come with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He reveals it through his word, rightly divided. 1 Corinthians 2, verse number 9. 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of men, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. By the way, maybe we should start back in verse 7. 1 Corinthians 2, 7. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. And I start there because that's what Paul's talking about in chapter 3 of Ephesians. We speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom, which God ordained before the world unto our glory. So here Paul's talking about the same thing he's talking about in Ephesians 3. Verse 8, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. That tells you why he kept it secret. But as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither hath it entered into the heart of man, the things which God hath prepared for them that love him. Nobody, based on the way we know things, the eye gate, the ear gate, and the heart gate, could have understood or thought out or figured out this mystery, this secret. God kept it secret, and you couldn't figure it out. But God, verse 10, hath revealed it to them, revealed them, the things of God, unto us, how? By his Spirit. Now, how did the Spirit reveal it to you? This lady told me the other day, this Mormon lady, she says, well, the Spirit of God speaks to me. And I looked at her and said, no, he doesn't. She says, yes, he does. I said, no, he doesn't. Well, after we did that 4 or 5 times, she got mad. She says, well, how can you say that? I said, because I believe the Bible. The Bible says he doesn't. That didn't work. Well, it worked for me. It just didn't work for her. And she said, well, what is it? I said, well, I don't know what it is. Maybe you just dreamed it up. Maybe you're lying to me. I don't know you. And her husband was there, and he's doing like this. I got the idea he thought maybe that was the answer. But it isn't visions that the Holy Spirit gives you because he isn't doing that. How is it? Verse 13, which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teacheth, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth. Compare spiritual things with spiritual. Where would you find the words that the Holy Spirit teaches? Well, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. How do you get the Bible? Holy men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. The words which the Holy Spirit teaches have been inscripted, written down in a book, and you have a record of them. Now, the Holy Spirit spoke a lot of words that aren't in the Bible. He gave visions to people. He spoke to prophets in time past. And their words went out. We don't know what they were because they weren't recorded. But God then wrote some of those words down in a book so they could be preserved through time so you could have them. And every word that he spoke that you need to know about, he wrote in this book. And that's how he reveals his word. And so while you can't figure it out on your own, you'll never grasp the mystery by yourself, he has revealed them unto us by the Spirit writing down some words. And so that's why Paul says back over here, if you want to understand this secret, you read my epistles. Because it was kept secret in ages past, but it's now revealed by his Spirit through the words that I'm writing down and that I'm teaching. My point to you, and I keep trying to emphasize this, the way the Holy Spirit works, the way he reveals things, is when you read your Bible. If you don't read your Bible, you're not going to get any revelation from God the Holy Spirit. Now, you might get some revelations. The kids had pizza this afternoon. And, you know, you can get revelations eating pizza. You know, you get heartburn, have all kind of visions of your head upon your bed. Chrissy Bellis was telling me this morning that she had the surgery this past week. And she said that the first day when she was home, before she had the surgery, that she's at the hospital, she had a gallbladder attack. And she went and they gave her morphine and the Norco. And she said, well, the pain went away and I was feeling pretty good. Then the Norco wore off and she says, I wasn't feeling so good anymore. Well, when I had the heart surgery, I was on a cocktail of narcotics like that the 3 days after the surgery. And I saw all kinds of interesting things. There was a beautiful marching band that would walk through the window, come up and walk through the window of my room. They had beautiful orange and white uniforms. And they never played anything. They just walk right through, right out the door. Now, they weren't really there. My son is sitting there one day, and I said, David, put your hand on the wall. He did. And I said, is that wall moving? He said, no, Dad. I said, yeah, it is. It's scrolling up like the wallpaper scrolling like a computer screen. It wasn't. But I can tell you, as real as you are sitting there, it was doing it in my mind. The one my wife likes to tell the most about was the Fuddruckers sign. Now, I don't know when the last time you ate at Fuddruckers, but it had been a while for us because the one close to us closed up. But there was a red Fuddruckers sign, flap, 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 flap. And she says, there's no, I said to her, I know it's not there. I know I'm the only one in the room that can see it, but it's there. Now, it wasn't real, but it was real in my mind. So if the Holy Spirit, if someone gives you a vision and it's real in your mind, it doesn't have to come from God. It could come from narcotics. It could come from hallucinations. My point is it can be just as real in your experience, but the only way you know if it came from God is it came out of His Word. That's how the Holy Spirit works, through His Word. That being the case, look down at chapter 3, verse 16. Paul prays for them that He would grant you according to the riches of His glory to be strengthened with might by His Spirit in the inner man. So where's the Holy Spirit's mighty, miracle-working power going to operate in your life? In your inner man. And it's going to do that so that Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith. It's your faith resting on the truth of God's Word to you that allows the Spirit of God to strengthen your inner man. The outward man perishes. Someone asked me the other day, do you pray for sick people? Duh. Certainly. The question isn't, do you pray for? The question is, what do you pray for? I don't go to the hospital and say, oh, Lord, I just pray for it be your will. You'd guide the doctor's hands and heal this person. I mean, that's about as pagan a thing as you could think about praying. How in the world do you think God's going to guide the hands of some doctor? I mean, explain to me how you think that's going to happen. And nobody can explain that to you. The people that do it, gets weirder and weirder and weirder, more oddball and oddball. But I'll tell you what you can pray. You can pray Scripture. We know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now, not only they, but we ourselves, which are the first fruits of the Spirit. If you're in the hospital because you have some physical malady, you know why you're there? You're there because you're part of a fallen creation. You know what's going to happen? Your outward man's going to perish. Do the best you can, it's still going to perish. You know that little 10-year-old girl's up in the hospital with a brain tumor? She lives in a fallen creation, and the curse of sin on creation is random. It hits anybody and everybody somewhere. And she lives a part of that. So her outward man is perishing. But you know what you'd see when you talk to her? Her inward man is renewed day by day. Because that's the part of you that you never lose. Whether you're 10 years old or 100 years old, Stacy's grandma that just died was 93 years old, no matter what your age, the only thing you can lose is what you're going to lose anyway. The things that are eternal, you can't lose. So what's really real? Those things. What strengthens you is His truth in your inner man, that no matter what circumstance you go through, you have the capacity to have Christ at home in your life and living for His glory. Chapter 4, verse 4, he says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The unity of the Spirit is the unity that God made when He put you into Christ. Verse 4, there's one body, one Spirit, even as you're calling, one hope of your calling. The one Spirit baptizes the believer into the one body. Verse 5, he says, there's one Lord, one faith, one baptism. So the one baptism by the one Spirit into the one body, that's the unity that God has made when He put you into Christ. And he said, our function is to not try to make it, it's just to keep it. What God, the Holy Spirit, has already done, we simply rest in and enjoy. And when you do, chapter 5, verse 9, chapter 5, verse 8, for ye were sometime darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth. See what it says, the fruit of the Spirit? The Spirit of God brings is the Spirit of life. I love that verse in 1 Thessalonians. It says that they turn to God from idols to serve the true and living God. You are the church of the living God. There's life in Christ Jesus. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made us free from the law of sin and death. We have His life, and life produces fruit. That's what it does. The fruit of the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, so on and so forth, that's the result of Him working through your life, producing the character of the Lord Jesus Christ. Philippians chapter 1, verse 11, he says, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and praise of God. God gives you His righteousness. And if you have the righteousness of God, the justice of God can give you His life. And that righteousness that you have that produces the life of Christ bears fruit in your life. And literally it enables you in your life where you live and the circumstances you live in to literally have an outbreak of the righteous character of God. That's what the fruits of the Spirit are. Right on the stage of human history where you are. So you come to Ephesians 6, verse 17 and 18, you find the last two references. Ephesians 6, verse 17, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Two things. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. When the Spirit of God wants to go out and do battle, take the offense, He does it with His Word. And prayer, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Praying in the Spirit, praying in line with what the Holy Spirit's doing. Where did you learn that? You learned that in His Word. So you're taking the offense in the Christian life by applying the Word of God to the details of life through prayer. Prayer is an issue. It's not an issue of begging God to give you stuff. You already have everything God has for you. To get added things is not added life. You have all the life you'll ever need in Christ Jesus. The application of His Word to the details of life. Prayer is, when he talks about praying always with all prayer and supplication, watching with all perseverance, supplication is to ask God about stuff. So I have the details of my life, things come along, and I talk to God about them. I pray about them. I make requests, supplication. I say, Lord, I need wisdom to do this. I need how to do that. Where am I going to find the answer? I go to His Word. I find out what His Word says about the circumstances, the situation that I'm in, that I'm facing. And then I take that answer from His Word, and I work out how to apply that. Yesterday I was visiting, Cynthia and I were visiting Charlotte, the little 10-year-old, in the hospital. And her dad was relating to me. He said, this morning, Charlotte, she still can't see with her eyes because of the tumor. And she got vision, but she can't see clearly. And she asked him, said, when we get to heaven, will we get new eyes? Well, that's a good thought. And he says, yes, sugar, we will. And he opened the Bible up and showed her Philippians 3, verse 20 and 21, about getting a glorified body, so on and so forth. And she says, yes, I remember that verse. Had it in her mind. And the great thing is, he knew where the verse was to show her. You know, I said this morning, it's in the Bible, but if you don't know where it's in the Bible. But as you study the Scripture, say you didn't know where it was, and you had the question, what would you do? You go to the Bible, look for an answer. And if you go to the Bible, look for an answer, and you say, boy, I don't know how to study this book. How should I study it? Now I'm going to ask the Bible how to study itself, and it tells me that I need to rightly divide it. All of a sudden, my prayer life is the catalyst for me studying Scripture so that I have the understanding to apply to the details of my life. So prayer and the Word of God, the Word is, people say, sort of like the food, and prayer is sort of like breathing. The two go hand in hand in the Scripture. You never separate one over here and the other over there. So that it's the Word of God that works effectually in you that believe, because it's your faith that releases the operating of the Holy Spirit into your life to take that Word and to make it life and energy in your inner man. So those references to the Spirit of God starts with your sealing, works all the way through to taking that identity you have in Christ and putting it into operation in your life on a daily basis and having a life that has the Spirit of God working through you in the real object, not the imaginary, not emotion-based, but the real objective working of God, the Holy Spirit. And it's just like Genesis chapter 1. The Spirit of God moves upon the face of the waters. He moves in your life, and He said, He moves in it through His Word. Amen. Ephesians is the highest ground of grace truth. And the ministry of the Holy Spirit in it is critically important because it tells you exactly how God works in your life for His glory. Okay? Father, thank You tonight for Your love and Your grace to us, for the fact that we can relax and trust You. And as we do it, see You actively, powerfully, wonderfully, working in our lives, in all the minutiae of our lives, things that honor You. And we thank You for that privilege in Christ's name.